I lived in one of these monsters for 5 months.
Basically, they are being roasted alive, deafened, choked, and of course, shot at.
A car bomb, if it's large enough, can still destroy or severely immobilize a tank.
There was no significant damage to a single Challenger in the First Gulf War from enemy fire.
As the face of warfare changes, the weapons that won the battles of the 20th century face a grim challenge. They must evolve, adapt, or they will be retired. The main battle tank. In many ways, it is the icon of 20th century warfare. But in the 21st century, how relevant will it be? How effective will it be? And how much will it cost?
There is a move afoot to say, this chap is too big, it's outdated, it's far too heavy to get into an operational area very quickly. And those arguments, I'm sure, are absolutely true.
The modern main battle tank is hugely different to how it started, and it may well be reaching the end of that evolutionary process. So by the end of the 21st century, if we look ahead another 90, 100 years, we may not even have tanks on the battlefield at all.
After 2 years of bloody attrition and millions of dead, the Western Front was mired in static trench warfare. But in November 1916, the British unleashed a new weapon, 28 tons of heavy metal. It had tracks to cover rough ground, a pair of 6-pounder guns, and armour to protect the crew. The tank had arrived on the battlefield.
They were called land ships when they first appeared. To my mind, these have very little to do with the tank of today. The reason is they're designed really as a battering ram to cross a fire-swept area, that's an area swept mainly by machine gun fire, to crush down the barbed wire that was holding up the British infantry and to clear a path for them into the enemy trenches. That done, in theory, their role was over.
The Mark I tank was slow, lightly armoured, and its guns stuck out awkwardly to both sides. But what it offered was a combination of protection, mobility, and firepower. This was a unique weapon of warfare.
The guns on the sides are actually carried in what are known as sponsons. There were two reasons. The first is that the very shape of these tanks, the way the track runs all the way around them like that, is done in order to get the maximum possible cross-country performance. In other words, they could go into a shell hole out the other side. Far better, theoretically, than the modern tank can do. Because of that, you didn't want too much weight on top. It had to be somewhere else, and the side was better. There is another reason. Smack bang in the middle of this thing is a 105 horsepower petrol engine. If they'd have had a turret in the conventional way, it would have been right on top of the engine and everyone would have been roasted alive. It just wouldn't have worked.
Let loose for the first time in the village of Flair, the Mark I tank ushered in a new age of warfare. Peering through the smoke of battle at the huge metal monsters spitting fire and flame, the Germans turned tail and ran. A new phrase entered the lexicon of war, tank fright. At first, nothing the Germans could put in its way managed to stop the tank.
A mail tank carries a 57mm cannon in each side. It's a single-shot firing thing designed for dealing with high-explosive rounds against machine gun posts or solid shot, say against a pillbox or something. On the other hand, the machine gun armed tanks, which were the females, are designed primarily to kill people. In a First World War context, they built more of the female than the male because they were, to coin a phrase, deadlier than the male. They were far more use against infantry, which was really all there was to shoot at.
In very short order, the tanks had punched a 2-kilometre hole in the defences, which had withstood months of relentless artillery barrage and wave after wave of infantry assault. the Allies were not able to follow up their success, but the tank had demonstrated its potential. It had shown that it could tip the scales of war and bring to an end the horror of the trenches. The Germans did begin to fight back. They sprayed the oncoming tanks with machine gun fire. Some bullets did manage to get in between the spaces in the tank's plated armour. The effect of this was to fire red-hot jets of lead over the crew inside. To protect themselves from the so-called spalling, the crew had to wear chainmail like the knights of old.
You have heat so hot it's almost unbearable, and the engine leaks, so the tank the whole time is swirling with carbon monoxide, so everyone in it is half daft before they even go into action.
The noise was deafening, and the crew had to use hand signals to communicate with each other. Communication also was only one way back to HQ, and this was done by carrier pigeon. The Germans quickly learned to use other countermeasures, such as digging huge pits which they filled with water. These they called tank graben. If the tanks drove into these, their engines would stop. They would also bundle together sticks of grenades and lob these in the path of oncoming tanks. And as the tank fright lessened, squads of specialised infantry tank killers began to hunt the British tanks. Even at this early stage of its development, the tank wasn't going to have things all its own way on the battlefield. Right from the start, there were those who questioned the tank's utility. When it was used piecemeal at Arras and Ypres, the weapon was seen to fail in the soft mud. It was then massacred by German artillery.
If conditions were appalling as they were, say, in the Ypres salient in 1917 when it was liquid mud, they were absolutely hopeless. But used properly, which is en masse against a prepared defence position, they could be quite effective. No doubt at all that where these things appeared, they saved lives because the infantry allowed the tank to go first and absorbed the first punishment that was coming for them.
The tank really showed its potential in the Battle of Cambrai in November 1917.
We used nearly 400 tanks and for a while, a very brief while, achieved one of the greatest successes of the First World War.
The Germans were taken aback, and in a desperate attempt to stop this onslaught, they mounted a 77mm anti-aircraft gun on the back of a truck. And this is where the anti-tank side of the story begins. I'm sitting here on a German 1897 designed and built 77mm field piece. This is an artillery piece originally, and this particular one was responsible for knocking out two British tanks. It was captured by the British, but what they realised was the Germans were taking the fuses out of their high explosive shells and using what was called solid shots, so the first armour-piercing round, a solid piece of metal which would punch into and through the tank itself. If they were lucky, they'd get a hit on the petrol tank or the engine, and the thing would blow up and vaporise. If they were unlucky, it would pass straight through and out the other side. And what we saw in the First World War was lots of British tanks peppered with holes.
The impact of a shell on one of these things is a bit like the lottery, only the results can be somewhat more even. There are plenty of instances of the tank being struck repeatedly, of great holes appearing in it, and as long as the shell passing through doesn't hit anything vital, and the crew, and there's eight men in here, mind you, will lie flat on the floor the minute they come under fire, all of them, if they can. Holes appear, and the thing will come trundling on, the old engine slogging away. It'll go out of battle, but it'll be in one piece. There are just as many instances, and you can read about them in the records of a chap saying, I looked from my tank, I saw the tank next to me moving forward, I looked away for a second, looked back, it had gone. So that one shell and the whole tank has vanished in a great explosion of ammunition and fuel.
Perhaps the best demonstration of the tank's power in World War I came at Amiens in late 1918, when 600 Mark V's tore a hole 10 by 30 kilometres in the German defences. The Germans knew at that point that the war was lost. The tank had arrived on the field of battle and was there to stay.
To any British infantry, or Commonwealth infantry come to that, who fought alongside the British tank during the First World War, they never wanted to go into action without them again.
What the tank did was it rendered the fixed trench and barbed wire defences immediately obsolete. Trench warfare was over. Beaten badly by the tank in World War I, the Germans invent a whole new way of fighting with it at the start of World War II. They call it Blitzkrieg or Lightning War, and at its heart is the tank. Tanks and armoured vehicles used in massive formations with infantry, artillery and close air support. This was the essence of combined arms warfare. Its effect on anyone who gets in its way was devastating. The world watched in horror as panzers smashed through Poland. Not even the French army, thought at the time to be the best in the world, could withstand the panzer tidal wave. Buoyed by their success in the west, the Germans turned east into Russia, Operation Barbarossa. Making deep thrusts and encirclements in classic Kesselschlacht or cauldron battles, their panzer formations killed or captured vast chunks of the Soviet army. But there were three things that brought German blitzkrieg to a halt: their immensely long supply lines, the severe Russian winter, and the new Russian T-34 and KV heavy tanks. The T-34 came as a very unpleasant surprise to the Germans. Superbly designed, it was superior in every aspect of protection, mobility, and firepower to any German tank of the early war period. The main German anti-tank weapon of the day was a 37mm anti-tank gun. The shells of the 37mm pack simply bounced off the T-34's revolutionary sloped armour. The disgusted German crews gave their gun a new name, the door knocker.
If you slope a piece of armour plate at 45 degrees and your round strikes it head on, that round has got double the thickness of armour plate to penetrate. And that's what the Russians do with the T-34 tank in 1941, and the Germans copy it with the Panther tank the following year.
Often touted as the best tank of World War II, the Panther was, in many ways, flawed. It was very complex, introduced before field trials were complete, and mechanically unreliable. A lack of confidence in your equipment is the last thing you need in the heat of battle. The Panther had an unimpressive debut at Kursk.
Weight is always a problem. This is the problem the German army had in the Second World War. The more armour protection, or any kind of protection, you put on your tank tends to increase its weight. Now, some people will say that that's fine. What we really want to do is protect the vehicle, keep it in being, and protect the crew inside. And after all, one of your most valuable assets are your crew. With a Challenger crew, an enormous amount of financial resources invested in training them over several years. Once you lose the crew, you can't easily replace them. If you get a tank that's too heavy, it can't go across temporary bridges. Its cross-country mobility may well be limited, but it can shrug off all the anti-tank weapon systems thrown at it. So a good example in the Second World War would be the Tiger. There was a lot thrown at it, and it was generally considered proof against most counter-tank weapon systems.
In the late summer of 1941, the Germans were in for a real shock. Blitzkrieg ground to a halt in the face of beasts like this one, the KV-1. Weighing in at 47 tons, this Russian tank was twice anything the Germans had. And the Germans found that they had to work their way around to the back of this tank to take a rear shot or try and blow the tracks off to disable it. In the Western Desert, the British had to learn very fast. Their initial engagements were successful, but when they came up against determined German anti-tank defences, they showed the world how not to do it, sending waves of unsupported cruiser tanks against the Africa Corps. The Germans were dug in with anti-tank guns, and the new German 88 blew them apart at long ranges. The British very quickly learned that tanks used on their own are no match for a sound defence.
If you look at their early development, Panzer II, Panzer III, Panzer IV, it is eminently logical, which you'd expect of the Germans, and it is all offensive. In other words, the tank's gun is improving, but not its protection quite so much. You get onto the Tiger, and the Germans have gone to the defensive. Yeah. And I think that's where the change comes.
This is the German Tiger I tank. It's a tank that everybody recognises, the icon of the German panzer forces during the war. However, only 1,300 of these machines were built, compared to tens of thousands of Shermans and T-34s. In some respects, it's a testament to German inefficiency. For example, very complex design. Here we see these interleaved road wheels, very difficult to change in the field and typical of this complex machine. It took over 300,000 man-hours to build one of these, compared to one-tenth of that or less for Allied machines. One of the weapons that all tank crews fear most, even today, is the fighter bomber. In Normandy, the Germans learned this lesson the hard way. Striking from above, the 60-pound rockets fired from a Typhoon opened up the mighty Tiger like a tin can.
Does air power dominate the battle space? It is the question we need to ask for the rest of the 21st century. And it seems at the moment that the answer is yes. But what happens when you come up against a determined enemy who are as well equipped in the air as you?
An attack helicopter with that amount of firepower, if used correctly, is a very, very attractive weapon system indeed. I still think there's a combination here that you require. Attack helicopter 9 kilometres away from an enemy position isn't going to inspire somebody to say, we've got to give up. One of these beasts, or several of these beasts, or 150 like I had, is certainly going to persuade the enemy that it isn't worth going on.
Many people argue what was the best tank to come out of World War II. Was it the T-34 or the Panther or the Tiger? But I think the best design certainly to come out of World War II was this one, the British Centurion. It had the perfect balance of firepower, mobility and protection, and it set the pattern for all of today's main battle tanks. The Centurion was an exceptional tank and proved its worth in the Arab-Israeli wars. It would lead to the development of an even better tank. As far as tank design goes, it was arguably the Brits who hit on the optimum solution in the late 1950s with this, the Chieftain. For 30 years, this tank was the envy of the world. It seemed to have the right balance of everything. A big 120mm gun, excellent armour protection, good cross-country performance. And when you look at all modern main battle tanks, they're pretty much unchanged from the British Chieftain. The best exponent of blitzkrieg tactics post-World War II was the Israeli army. The Israelis achieved a string of lightning victories in 1956 and 1967, and it seemed that the Israeli army, led by its tank force, was the best in the world and was absolutely unbeatable. In the Six-Day War in 1967, an Egyptian army, equipped with the very best the Soviet Union could supply, Joseph Stalin 3s, T-10s and T-54-55s, proved no match for the Israeli crews, who were armed with a mix of US-supplied Super Shermans and British Centurions. 1967 saw the tank at the height of its power and the Israeli tank arm as a world beater, but it was about to get a bloody nose. In October 1973, during the Jewish holiday of Yom Kippur, Arab forces launched a two-pronged attack on Israel. Syrian T-62 tanks poured across the Golan Heights to the north, while the Egyptian army attacked across the Suez Canal in the south. The Israelis were confident they could repeat the easy victories of 1967, but when the shooting war started, the overconfident tank crews got the surprise of their lives. Superior tank gunnery helped the Israelis deal with the Syrian T-62s. But it was on the Sinai front that the Israeli tanks were in for a real shock. The anti-tank guided missile had arrived on the scene. The main difference between World War II tank combat and modern tank combat is the anti-tank guided missile. With their first serious combat debut in 1973, they caused a revolution in warfare. Egyptians deployed the AT-3 Saga, and these were able to pick off overconfident Israeli tankers at between 2 and 3 kilometres. In the desert terrain, these missiles could trash Israeli tanks at ranges out to 3,000 metres. But the Saga was the product of more than 50 years of anti-tank development.
As far as the Germans were concerned, the first rule in the book when tanks appeared was to fire everything at it. You could chuck stones at it if you wanted to. Just everybody shoot at the tank, you might do it some damage. When they started developing anti-tank weapons, they used things like clusters of stick grenades, which some unreasonably brave individual was supposed to run up and chuck under the tracks if he's going to get that close. They developed a huge bolt-action anti-tank rifle towards the end of the war, which just about broke your collarbone every time you fired it. And again, you had to be 100 yards or less from the tank to do it. Their main development was actually using standard field guns, something of 77mm caliber, which was wheeled out into the open and took the tanks on over open sights. The famous business at Flesquières during the Battle of Cambrai, when something like 18 British tanks were taken out by a German battery, is a good example of how vulnerable these things were to really good, well-aimed artillery fire.
In the case of the British, there is a rather bizarre anti-tank rifle, the Boys anti-tank rifle, which is developed, issued to platoons who use it in the German invasion of France in 1940. And you get after-action reports, eyewitness accounts of British soldiers witnessing their rounds bouncing off the armour plate of German vehicles. We need a new route down which to travel, and the Germans get there first. The Panzerfaust, literally armoured fist. This is a throwaway anti-tank weapon. It's basically a piece of drain pipe with a primitive sight and an armoured warhead at the end of that. You can fire it at an armoured vehicle 60 to 100 metres away. Throw it away and get another. It's light, it's portable, and you can produce them by the million. They can be used by individuals who can carry several at a time, and you can get Panzerfaust companies equipped with nothing else. The Americans go down the route of a bazooka, again a large kind of stovepipe, which fires effectively an anti-tank round that you might fire from a gun inside a tank. The British unfortunately choose the route of a rather ham-fisted design called a PIAT, projectile infantry anti-tank, which is a device basically with a large spring that hurls a warhead at a tank with varying degrees of success. It's the sort of thing we might associate with Captain Mannering and the Home Guard, but unfortunately it's issued to mainline British units who all look at particularly the German and American models of anti-tank weapons with enormous envy. They score more hits more often, are lighter to carry and far more efficient. And of course it's the Panzerfaust, that throwaway model, which is the forerunner of what the Soviets design, the RPG, the rocket-propelled grenade. Mass-produced and mass-copied around the world, extremely cheap to buy, usually comes in two different kinds of an anti-armour and an anti-personnel warhead. They'll do different things, but they're a very cheap way of destroying lightly armed vehicles, armoured personnel carriers, or poorly protected tanks.
Talking about knocking out T-54, 55 and 62 by RPG, I didn't see any knocked out tanks from the front, to be honest with you. I've seen burned tanks. Some of them were knocked out mainly from the side or back or from the top. But I'm not sure whether RPG can get through the frontal layer of armor. But it could be the case, you know, you never know. If you're lucky enough to strike into some sort of technological joints where it was welded or something, you might get lucky, but I'm not sure. I didn't see those.
You don't normally take tanks into built-up areas. It's a dangerous place for a tank to be. There could be mines around. There can be people firing down from high-rise blocks onto the top of the tank. It didn't happen in Basra, fortunately, and when they did fire at it with RPG, it simply bounced off the sides. A very effective weapon system in those circumstances.
OK, so let's take a look at the rapid developments in anti-armour weaponry that happened in World War II. Well, the British started off with this little baby. This is the two-pounder solid shot. Unlike World War I, shot made of high-grade steel instead of cast iron, but really wouldn't go through very much, certainly not through the more powerful German tanks. By the end of the war, we have this baby, 88mm or 25-pounder solid shot. The Russians even developed a 120mm version of this. But technology was not to be left behind, because the British had and Americans had developed tungsten carbide. And this round here, the APDS, or armor-piercing discarding sabot, This here is the charge bag. So this is the gunpowder charge and shell casing, which fires this out of the barrel. This is what actually flies out at the end of the gun barrel. This particular one is 120 millimeters, so 12 centimeters across. Now, it comes out of the barrel and these bits fly off. So what we're left is this projectile flying through the air. Now this here is only made of aluminium on the outside, but on the inside, as you can see, it weighs quite a lot, is this here, the penetrator. Now this weighs about 8 kilograms, comes in two parts, penetrator cap and penetrator itself. The velocity of this is around 1500 meters per second, as opposed to a maximum velocity of about 1200 meters per second of solid shot. So you get much greater penetration. If you look behind me here at this armored test bed, what we can see is one of these rounds here, which has penetrated this particular hole here. And this cap here, this makes a dent so that this can go through the side of any armor and actually make a big hole inside. So that's where we were at the end of World War II. And then along came the fin. Well, what's that? In essence, this is the fin. Armor piercing, fin stabilized, discarding sabot. Apart from the charge, the whole round looks like this. And you can see that charge bag on the bottom, just as before. We have these drive bands here. These come off as soon as the round leaves the barrel. These things here are the sabots, and these fly off, leaving our fin to fly towards our enemy tank. So just how good are the latest versions of the fin? Well, here we have a test slab, and this one apparently was penetrated at a range of 2 miles. That's 3,000 meters, and this is about 50, 60 centimeters of armor. And you can see here, if you look closely, the rippling effect there is it's liquefied the metal as it's gone through. In Gulf War I, one of these fin rounds fired from an American M1 Abrams passed straight through the side of two Russian-made tanks parked side by side. It's no wonder that the crews refer to these as their silver bullets.
It literally tears everything inside the turret or the driver compartment to bits. So not only, obviously, human beings won't survive, but also the equipment is destroyed as well. All the sighting, which is sensitive stuff, and the cables are just ripped apart. It might not cause an explosion. Now, here you have a problem, because if you're firing at a tank at, let's say, 2 kilometers range, and you fire one of these darts, these DU rounds, into it, you'll see a little flash of light, and the tank will probably stop. But what you don't know is quite how much damage you've done. You must assume you've done an enormous amount of damage, but it's not 100% certain that you've knocked that tank out.
This is the HESH round, high explosive squash head, beloved of the British. What it does is it penetrates only about that far into armor. I don't know if you can see on the slab of armor, but on the outside, there's only a very, very shallow depression. And what this shell does is it squashes itself in and sends a massive shockwave through to the inside. And it's this red hot metal spool that flies around the inside of the tank, destroying and shredding anything and everything inside.
We stow the ammunition below what is known as the bustle, as far down as possible, so it's safer and will not necessarily be hit by a tank round that's hitting the turret. The Soviets don't give a damn about that, and they'll stow tank rounds any way they like. And so when a tank round does penetrate the turret, there will be an explosion. You get a complete detonation, the turret blows off, and you destroy the ammunition, the whole thing. It's clearly you've defeated it. Now, with armor-piercing round, which flies almost parallel to the ground with such power, it probably starts to drop after 2 or 2.5 kilometers. So if it's over 2.5 kilometers, you might not use it. But the HESH round, as we call it, which has got a higher trajectory, this, of course, you can fire at far greater ranges. And we are engaging enemy tanks at plus of 3 kilometers or 3.5 kilometers. I think I even heard of a hit at 5 kilometers, which is phenomenal, but totally possible. As if you can see the tank, you can fire at it with one of these HESH rounds.
Some argue that anti-tank weapons have now won the tank anti-tank race. Certainly, an awful lot of money is invested in anti-tank weapon systems. They're relatively cheap to develop. In terms of export sales, it's probably easier to win a contract to sell 10, 20, 30,000 anti-tank weapon systems than it is to sell 50 or 100 tanks to another country. So there's an enormous focus on developing anti-tank weapon systems of all sorts of different kinds. That brings us on to the developments in tank protection and whether the risk and payoff between protection and anti-tank capability is being won by the tank manufacturers or not.
From the balance of the T-34 design, we see this one here, the T-55, and we see this same basic design going right through today to the T-90. And the question is, how do you keep this kind of tank going when it's faced with urban combat situations, when it's faced up against modern anti-tank rounds or rocket-propelled grenades? One of the solutions is to add on this kind of slabbed armour. It increases the protection. In particular, it increases the protection against things like rocket-propelled grenades and high-explosive anti-tank rounds. The problem, of course, is if you increase the protection, you increase the weight, but you decrease the mobility, and that's where you lose out.
Load! Loaded!
The tank designers realised that the anti-tank guided missiles were supreme and had no answer to them at all. So what the Russians and Israelis developed was a countermeasure. It's called reactive armour. Reactive armour is bricks of high explosive material which are essentially fixed onto the front and sides of a tank, and this is to protect the tank against the shaped charge rounds. When the reactive armour bricks are struck by the high explosive rounds, they explode, and this explosion in turn on the outside of the tank disrupts the high temperature jet of molten metal.
Reactive armour is expensive, and some nations take the view that they need their tanks in action, their enemy will not have sophisticated anti-tank capabilities, so they'll run the risk of not providing their armour in certain environments with a full suite of anti-tank armour.
But faced with the new problem of effective armour on the battlefield, the anti-tank manufacturers had to think again. They realised that one simple shape charge could be beaten by reactive armour. So the very latest anti-tank rounds now have a double-shaped charge. They have one charge which actually blows away the reactive armour, or detonates it, and the second charge goes through the armour itself. In essence, there are five ways to kill a tank. There are anti-tank guns, anti-tank rockets, guided missiles, mines, and of course bombs dropped by aircraft. The best anti-tank guns are those mounted on the tanks themselves. No modern tank can survive a frontal hit from another modern tank gun from under 800 metres.
The one thing you don't really want to do is get involved in street fighting because, you know, with a tall building, it's possible, therefore, for an anti-tank weapon to look down. But if they haven't got good air forces, top attack will be very difficult on this, so you know, they really have to rely on mines, and the belly is not that thick.
Other than air power, perhaps the thing that the tank crew fears the most is the anti-tank mine. The problem with mines is that they can be anywhere, and when they detonate up and rip into the soft underbelly of the tank.
In the rubble across the road, his warrior armoured vehicle had detonated a landmine. Anti-personnel mines were also strewn in the debris. The colonel attempted to pick a safe path out for his men. It needed keen eyesight and a strong nerve, and snipers were in the surrounding hills. The mere threat of the warrior's gun turning on the sniper's position, though, stopped the incoming fire. It allowed the colonel enough time to find a way out and take control of the recovery of his vehicle and his men.
Tank manufacturer trials show us just how good and how mobile the modern tank can be. But throwing tanks around like this, across this sort of terrain, is not recommended in the user manuals. It tends to break the tank,
or the gun, or the transmission, or the tracks, or the driver's front teeth. To an enemy, a tank that's out of action for mechanical reasons or any other reason is just as ineffective as one that's been taken out by an anti-tank missile.
What Western nations would hope for is perhaps no more than a mobility kill. A tank is disabled in some way, so the crew remain protected. They can carry on fighting, they can probably communicate, but in some way their mobility is impaired. And a lot of armour or protection on a modern tank is designed to deflect the worst of shots and ensure that the best sort of compromise is ended up with.
Modern tanks suffer many of the same drawbacks as those early land ships. Even the best modern main battle tank requires up to 8 hours of maintenance every day, and this is just to keep it in running order.
Reliability is an interesting question. The tendency is, and this applies throughout the history of the tank, that in action, where men's lives depend on it, they tend to keep the tank better. In training, with a new tank, you'll hear endless complaints about failures. It's because it doesn't matter.
Now, the poor old Iraqis were not well trained, their equipment was of a much lower standard than ours, and their morale was rock bottom. They weren't even getting food by the time we attacked. It was a very unequal contest in that respect.
One of the great things about the tank, unlike the more fragile helicopter and fast jet, is that even though they break down, they can be quickly repaired, and the breakdowns are often not fatal. Experience shows that even with combat losses, 60% of those tanks can actually be repaired and put back into action.
People have been saying for a long time, the day of the tank is over, we got various things, were defeated. It's still doing very well. Over 100 nations in the world have got tanks, for the very good reason is that they are hugely powerful bits of equipment.
The evolution of the tank in the 21st century is now being impacted by the march of technology, which is racing ever faster. This isn't just in terms of the tank itself, it's in terms of weapon systems to counter the tank. The tank is a standard piece of equipment in every single fighting force in the world, but just as important are counter-tank weapon systems, whether they're mines or whether they're anti-tank weapons, whether it's a rifled weapon firing a shot or whether it's a missile. And the technological advances in all those different areas threaten the very future of the tank.
The shock of seeing a 60-ton monster is remarkable to an unsophisticated enemy. Will you be quite so moved by a 20-ton beast much smaller? And the answer is probably not. He may be when it actually fires at him, but the visual effect will no longer be there. Is this important? Yes, I think it probably is, if you're trying to control small wars around the world. We've actually put tanks into every situation where they can drive on the ground. But we've gone along with this philosophy, and now we're suddenly saying we can probably do it in a lighter way because we can get things out more quickly. Perfectly good argument. I would like the tank to remain rather longer till we know until FRES is a success or not.
FRES stands for Future Rapid Effects System. It's planned to enter service in 2007. It is a modular, air-portable design, weighs about 16 tonnes. The British Army's plans are to procure 2,000 of these to fulfil 15 or so battlefield roles, such as reconnaissance, armoured personnel carrier, infantry fighting vehicle, communications, command and control, and many, many more.
In an urban environment, what we have is a range of infantry fighting vehicles, armoured personnel carriers, whether we're talking Warrior and Bradley used by the coalition forces, or a whole range of other armoured vehicles. They are far more lightly armoured, therefore far more vulnerable to handheld anti-tank weapons, such as the RPG family. Now, how are they going to get on in an urban environment? The answer is they're extremely vulnerable unless they're working with dismounted infantry.
The West is moving away from the main battle tank, but this is based on one fundamental assumption, and that is that the West will always have the US on its side. Having the US on your side means that you have air power and air dominance. This means that any enemy, no matter what tanks he has, even our best main battle tanks, doesn't stand a chance against overwhelming air power.
While the new concepts coming along, such as Frez and Striker, may have many advantages, such as being deployable anywhere in the world, you can fit several of them into a large transport aircraft rather than just one big tank, they do have their drawbacks.
Can we afford to go down the route of Frez and keep this main battle tank going? The Americans can and have chosen to do it, which I think speaks volumes for my argument. I suspect that we will be very pushed to find the money to keep both systems running. If you have a smaller vehicle, it's harder to hit. I think with 20 tons and advanced armors, you will still be able to give a considerable amount of protection to the soldiers inside. The argument follows that if you, let's say, have a two-man crew, it's actually extremely tiring if you're fighting for 24 hours. How do you guard it? How do you look after it at night and so on and so forth if you're not fighting actually with the enemy at the time? Those are the sorts of arguments that we put forward for not reducing in size. But as soon as you come above 20 tons, you're not capable of flying it in. Does this matter? Well, I suppose ultimately in expeditionary warfare, you want to get there as quickly as possible to have an effect on the enemy, and therefore probably does matter. I go to the school that say, take a little longer, and actually a heavier equipment would be the way I would go, but that's only a personal view.
Frez poses the biggest real challenge to the heavy metal of the main battle tank. Frez has been described as the agent for transformation in the British Army, and whilst the challengers and warriors will serve for another 15 to 20 years, it is then that we'll see Frez armed with 120mm main guns, armed with the kind of computers and systems that will replace the British Challenger and also replace the Warrior. If these new armoured vehicles are going to have technology in them that is very similar to the modern attack helicopter, arguably you're also going to need a separate ground crew simply to maintain them.
The systems are getting safer and safer and more sophisticated. And of course, with more sophistication comes the problem of what happens when things go wrong. You need a whole series of reversionary modes to make certain you can keep fighting your tank once the computer goes, for instance.
Winning the information war is fine in theory, but from what we've seen so far of 21st century wars, they're messy. The information is scarce or incomplete. You need men on the ground in reconnaissance vehicles, and you will almost always need heavy metal backup.
One of the great influences all the way through, from at least the end of the First World War onwards, is a tendency to up armour and up gun. In other words, A decides that their tanks are too vulnerable, they slap more armour on, B decides they'll put bigger guns, and then more armour, bigger guns. It's been going on almost since these things were first built in one way or another. We could reach a position where the thing becomes so heavy that it really is an impractical piece of equipment. And it might be worth looking, for example, at the almost the warship idea of a citadel, in other words, a centrally heavily armoured portion for the crew, and the rest of it, the bits that make it go, not so vital, cut the weight down. So one could definitely see a move away from the heavy main battle tank of today.
The point about tanks is they're extremely expensive. A smaller weapon system that can pack an anti-tank missile, that can scoot around the battlefield at high speed, and use speed as its protection factor rather than armour plate, is appealing to a lot of governments. Since the fall of the Berlin Wall, governments around the Western world, in fact governments throughout the whole world, are expecting a peace dividend. They are trying all the time to reduce their defence budget. An easy target, if you like, for the treasuries of countries around the world is armoured vehicles. Hugely expensive. And there are alternatives which you can switch to which are relatively cheap by comparison.
A wily enemy will always be able to set up ambushes. He'll use RPGs, anti-tank missiles, roadside bombs, or even mines. And any soldier, I think, would much rather have 65 tons of heavy metal rather than 20 or even 30 tons to protect him.
But there's another way of looking at a tank, and that is its psychological value. We've said that in the Second World War, a tank that appears to be invulnerable, whether or not it is invulnerable, isn't so important. It's the perception that troops have on the ground.
Whatever the detractors of the main battle tank may say, there is nothing like parking your tank on the enemy's lawn. We've heard from all the experts,
that apart from its fantastic combat power, the pure psychological shock that the tank brings to the battlefield and the fear that it instills in the enemy means that the tank will survive. The tank is here to stay for a decade or two at least. But of course, armour development has also not reached the end of the trail. Recently, there have been some very interesting advances in armour technology. At the top secret UK Defence Science and Technology Laboratory at Fort Halstead in Kent, they have developed what they've called electric armour. What we see here is a trial where three rocket-propelled grenades are detonated against the side of a Warrior test vehicle. The plates you see on the side are electric armour plates. These have a current running through them, and what this does is it acts as a kind of force field. The force field acts very like reactive armour, in that it diffuses the high-temperature molten metal jet. And as you can see from this test, after suffering three direct hits, the Warrior emerges unbowed and with a few bumps and bruises to show for its trouble, whereas before, it might have been a smoking wreck with a beaten-up crew inside.
Rather than saying tanks for the memory, this piece of heavy metal has proved its worth even in urban combat. For the infantry, it has been a trump card, and my guess is that we'll see these machines around for some time to come, although their years may be numbered.